So how do we follow this in practice? We've looked at some of the examples from the standards, but let's look at how we apply this in practice. A recap on what we've done so far. If you've watched episode 1 and 2, we created a new project, and then we looked at using the EIR and the BP templates for creating a pre-appointment set of documentation. And as we created that, it created us tabs for each of these in our project. And then we looked at how we can, in the scope, assign specific asset information requirements for each of the purposes. This was defining our asset registration. So what needs to be registered in the maintenance records, what needs planned maintenance, preventative maintenance. And then we looked at how we can assign specifically information requirements. I see somebody asking a question about COBE. So this is really the connection between the framework that is COBE for outputting. This is the list of actually what the requirements are. So defining what the item is, what the requirement is from an information perspective, who's responsible for doing it, when it's going to be part of the requirements definition for what the COBE handover should be.
And understand that you could do this with the client. Understand that you could do with this with the teams. If you're on the client side, do this with the design teams or the construction teams. Gathering the feedback right away, psychologically, you gain more commitment and agreement if you introduce them as early as possible to help you build these scopes.
Yep. Seeing the images, the reaction from an executive when they start to understand this from a visual perspective is really transformational. We've seen a lot of benefit there. So we talked in the previous webinars about how to get to that set of documentation and go through that tender process. Now let's look at the appointment process and understanding more about the responsibility matrix and the task and master information delivery plans that become that detailed set of appointment documentation. We talk about structured data, the asset, the task, and the master information delivery plans and the responsibility matrix. Imagine having all of that in the same place. So if we drag in from previous projects or from our suppliers that are providing this, as we build all of these up, we're able to define those requirements in a structured form all in the same project. So all of those asset requirements alongside all of the tasks that are needing to be carried out can be assigned to teams and be all in the same place. The next part is understanding that scope side of things, all of the different parts of the puzzle that we can define, whether it's descriptive, whether it's a document that's attached to it as a specification, some requirements, if the team, so here it's a structural team, if we're needing information requirements, if we need to specifically use an IFC wall for this object as we model it, as we define all of those in a structured way, it becomes a lot of data, a lot of information requirements. That's great, but how do we make it official? How do we actually put all of those together so that we can communicate and act on the information requirements?
And we don't want that document just tucked in a drawer somewhere.
Yep. First part is creating the appointment documents. And really importantly, these should be filtered per appointment. Instead of presenting somebody with a full, you know, 3-ring binder, 6-ring binder of everything that is required for the project, now we're able to filter it and say, we're just going to send the responsibility matrix for the architect filtered for their specific requirements. And that creates, based on the milestones, based on a whole bunch of other filters to make that intelligent, the document that's created, we can now assign to specific teams and say only these teams get access. And we can request certain signatures as an approval just by the simply clicking and checking the box to say, these are the people that need to approve it. They will get an email. As they get an email, they click on the email. They can write their signature or They can type their signature or write their signature. And as they do that, what's happening is every time a signature is added, if you've gone through that traditionally and very much the document signing, a well-known DocuSign company that is able to define, and every time a signature is applied, it becomes part of that signature page, which is affixed onto the original document. It's legally binding, it's secure. There's a lot of really good stuff on the website about what things that we've had to do in order to be able to comply with the regulations. And actually, one of the cool things about the platform approach is that teams who are approving, they actually have to be signed in using their profile. So there's an added layer of security over and above what is traditionally used in a DocuSign-based process. So what's next? We've talked about having a database that contains all of those information requirements that meet the purposes that have been defined in the EIR. And now we've talked about how you filter the requirements per appointment and have a simple workflow to get a signature. Well, when you've got that signature, the next webinars we'll be talking about how you can then use that information, either exporting it and using tools like Solibri, Power BI, et cetera, for checking, or through the integrated workflow inside of Planoly, you can manage the tasks in the scheduling and the tracking, scheduling and tracking, and then verify them in the verify module. So depending on your workflow and depending on how many, just depending on whether you want to do that in the same workflow or not, you can choose to show or hide whichever modules that you would like to use inside of the tool. And more on that in a future webinar. So a quick summary, make sure that you're using a simple framework for managing information, making it easier for teams to agree and making it much more likely that you're going to get the outcome that you're looking for. Make sure that the data that you collect is structured so that it can be used in automated checking later on. And make sure that when you're creating the appointment documents, creating a filtered contract is much more likely that you're going to get somebody to agree to and knowingly agree to something they can deliver. And then using e-signature makes it a lot more rapid. We see that over 50% of contracts using e-signature are actually approved within 24 hours, which is astonishing because usually it would take days or weeks sometimes to get approval on those. And keep it simple. We're really, really focused on keeping things as simple as possible and making it easier for your clients and delighting your clients so that they will do more and more work with you. A couple of resources to get started if you are just starting to look at using Planoly. The first one is the basics course, which is a series of 1 minute demos. And the second one is if you're ready to jump in with a company plan to get started, we have a masterclass which will take you through all of the different modules and help your teams to get started. So we've talked about all of these templates and collaborative tendering, collaborative contracting today. Now we'll be moving on to producing that information and how we're actually managing the tasks that have been formed as part of that contract, as the appointment.